Hello. Good evening, Rochester, Minnesota. My name is Robin Blumner. I am CEO of the Richard Dawkins Foundation for Reason and Science, and I'm welcoming all of you here tonight. We're going to have an evening of a little bit of science, a little bit of blasphemy, and a lot of fun. So hold on to your seats. It's going to be a bumpy ride. Well, I want to give you a general sense of what's going to happen tonight. We have Richard and Julia coming on in a minute. They will be speaking for something about 45 minutes to an hour, and then we're going to make it your turn. So we'll bring the house lights up a bit, and we will have roving microphones. We'll have two down here in the orchestra. We will have one in the balcony. So if you want to ask a question, raise your hand at that time and we'll try to get the microphone to you. And we'll do that for about a half hour. And then after that, in a room outside behind the doors there, we will have book signing availability. And Richard and Julia will both be there to sign books for you. And we will be there till the last book is signed. So even though the line might be long, rest assured that Richard makes it a point to get every book signed when you come with a book. And there's also a book sale opportunity there. So if you didn't come with a book or you want additional books, they'll be available for you. So you might wonder why we chose to come to Rochester, Minnesota, out of all places. We were urged here by Glenn Gaunt, who is in the audience here, and he really is the reason we are here tonight. So thank you, Glenn. But there's another reason, and maybe, you know, it might be apocryphal, it might not be true, but I understand that out of every city in the upper Northwest, or the upper Midwest, that this one has the highest IQ. So you're our natural people. You're one of us. So we're asking you also to be one of us and join the Richard Dawkins Foundation. If you haven't already, just go on the website, richarddawkins.net/join, and become a member. Be a proud card-carrying member of the Richard Dawkins Foundation. So now, it's my deep honor and pleasure to introduce Julia Sweeney, who is a remarkable actor, writer, comedian. You know her from Saturday Night Live. You know her from her extraordinary one-woman show, Letting Go of God, and her partner in conversation tonight, a man who truly, for this audience, needs no introduction, the remarkable and amazing Richard Dawkins.
Coming out. It's such an honor for me to be here and getting to talk to Richard Dawkins, who is I'm such a big fan of and was such a big part of my beautiful loss of faith story. And so I'm so excited to be able to talk to him. But one thing I was waiting to ask him until he was here, and I know a little bit about it, but I wanted you to elaborate about your own religious experience. Like, when did you... What kind of religion were you brought up in, if you were? And tell me about when you realized that it maybe wasn't the path for you.
Well, Julia, I wish I had a good story to tell like yours, because your story in Letting Go of God, of course, is absolutely riveting and holds audiences spellbound for, what is it, 2 hours?
Yes, let's talk about me.
Well, we'll do that in a moment. We'll do that in a moment.
No, but I want
My story, my equivalent of your two-hour story, takes about 15 seconds.
Okay, well, I want to hear it.
Okay. I had the good fortune not to be brought up Catholic. I was brought up with the weak tea version, the homeopathic version, the Anglican. So my parents actually were not and are not religious, but I was sent to Anglican schools where we went to chapel every day and we did prayers every day and things, and we learned scripture. But it wasn't really thrust down our throats, and so I wouldn't say that I had the same indoctrination to overcome.
But did your parents believe in God?
No.
But they didn't say that?
They didn't say that, no. They took us to church on Easter and Christmas and gave me a Bible when I was confirmed.
And they didn't talk about their relationship to God?
No. So I was confirmed into the Church of England.
And how old were you then?
13.
13.
And so at the age of about 9, I think I started to get doubts when I think my mother pointed out to me that there were lots and lots of religions.
Oh.
And it was immediately clear to me there was no obvious reason why the one I was brought up in was the correct one. I mean, it is a remarkable fact that a lot of people feel, isn't it good of God to make it that the one true religion happens to be the one I happen to have been brought up in?
Yes.
Well, I tumbled to that at about 9. But then I went back. I'm not quite sure why, and I was confirmed at the age of 13.
And did your parents push you to be confirmed?
No.
Were there other kids?
Everybody at the school was confirmed.
But what about in your family? Were you an only child?
I'm not an only child. There was no special pressure from the family. Everybody in the school, except there was one boy who was Roman Catholic. And he wasn't, I mean, he was, presumably was confirmed at the age of about 2 or something, I don't know.
No, it's 12. It's the same age, just a different ceremony.
Okay, right. And we all had to go to church every Sunday. He went to a different church in the company of the very attractive young assistant matron, so we rather envied him his his Roman Catholicism.
But when you were 13 and being confirmed, even though you had doubts...
No, I believed it then, and I attended confirmation classes with the vicar, who was a kind, avuncular man, and talked complete nonsense, but I had no... I didn't realize it was nonsense. I struggled to understand it. It was only later I realized it was nonsense.
And so then how did you realize it was nonsense? Was there a moment, or was it just a gradual thing?
I gradually lost Christianity and then was left with a kind of deistic belief that there must be some kind of creator because of the beauty of life and the elegance of life. I studied biology. And then it was when I finally understood Darwin, I suppose, that I suddenly realized there's absolutely no reason whatsoever. The last reason was gone, and then I became an atheist. And then was rather militant and did
Wait,
things
how old
like
were you then?
About 17, I refused to kneel down in chapel and things.
Oh.
So I and two friends used to sort of sit up like this while everybody else was kneeling down, and we gazed out over this sea of bowed heads. Felt very superior. But the school was very tolerant. I mean, there was no discipline about that. I mean, this was Anglicanism, so we could do whatever we liked. Yeah.
But what did your parents, were your parents, they just went on holidays?
Well,
I
didn't know this at the time, but my mother recently told me, she's 98, my mother recently told me that my housemaster at school actually summoned my parents.
Oh, really?
To tea, which is what we do in England.
And, when you're really in trouble.
And actually asked them to intervene and to stop me doing what I was doing.
You mean not kneeling?
Yes. And my father said, that's your problem. I refuse to have anything to do with it.
Oh, wow. But they didn't talk to you about it?
No.
You just never had a discussion about it?
No.
They went to tea today. Well, we won't discuss what happened.
I didn't even know they'd come to tea.
Wow. Okay. And so then by the time you were, say, 18, were you saying, that you were an atheist?
Yes.
Or
you
just would say that?
Oh, yes. Yes.
And then... Yeah, go ahead.
But what about you? I mean,
about you. No,
well, okay. We'll talk about me again in a minute. But I don't know, how many people have seen Julia's Letting Go of God?
Oh.
Okay. It's a wonderful show, and I absolutely adored every minute of it. It sort of stands out in memory. But there must be other stories that didn't get it, that didn't make the final cut, and which perhaps
you
could share
with us. Well, yes, because when I did my show, Letting Go of God, and I did it like I was, 40 years old in L.A. when I first started doing it, or older, I think 45, I don't know anymore, a long time ago. Anyway, much older now. Okay, but anyway, and people were surprised. Most of my friends in Hollywood and in show business came and said, the most shocking thing about your show is that you were ever religious. I had no idea. but most people said, I was brought up in a religion. When I was about 12, I realized that I didn't believe it anymore, and that was that. That seemed to be the most common thing that happened. And it was actually true for me also, but so there is a story that I didn't put in my show about me at about that age, 11, 12. It was not based on science because we really didn't have any science in our school, I realize now. It was more like I was sitting in church and I looked up and I had like an epiphany that it was all a lie. Like it was almost like God came to me and told me it was a lie. Okay, and but it felt like that. Like I was just sitting there and I just thought, oh my God, this is all a made up story. Like this whole thing is a big made up story and none of it's true. And it's so obvious it isn't true, but I didn't understand critical thinking and I got everything through inspiration. But anyway, I went to confession, and at that time in Catholicism, they were going through a little bit of a liberal time then, and they had changed the name of confession to reconciliation. And you went into a room with a priest, you weren't in the confessional, and you sat there with the priest, and he had his back to you, but you were in the same room. And so
was the idea of having his back to you, so he couldn't see your face?
Well, they started having you face the priest, but that was terrible. Like, the priest didn't want to look at you, and you didn't want to look at the priest. No one, there needed to be some feeling of anonymity, or like you, because it's, the idea is that the priest is just there as a vessel for God to be hearing you, and that they're not really hearing you, even though they are, and whatever. Okay, so the first thing was that you looked at the priest, and then that was a disaster, and so then they decided the priest would have his back to you. So anyway, they went back to the confessional after about 6 months of this, but we went through this time at that time. So I went in, and the priest was there with his back to me, and he said, tell me your sins, and I said, you know what, I don't believe it. I think it's all a big lie. I think somebody just made this up, and everyone's just following along. And that was a big deal because, I wasn't really an iconoclast and I wasn't that kind of person. And just to say that was a big deal. And then there was a big long pause. And then I started seeing his shoulders go like this. And I thought he was laughing. And that was actually an important moment because I turned red with embarrassment, like I was being laughed at. And I also suddenly thought, why are you saying that? You don't even have any evidence. And how do you know that? And as soon as I said it, I didn't necessarily believe it anymore. Like, I was completely, flooded with emotion and embarrassment. But then I realized that he wasn't laughing. He was crying.
Crying?
Yes, I made a priest cry. Okay, so then, and he was crying, and then I heard that he was crying. And that was, like, a really marked on my memory
why
forever.
Why do you think he was crying?
Well, I don't know. He didn't tell me. But he said, get out, just get out. And then I ran out of the confessional, and I was completely horrified. Like, it was such a huge, horrible thing. And I ran into the church and got on my knees in the first pew. I remember right where I was at St. Augustine's. And I said, dear God, I'm so sorry. Why did I do that? I will never not believe in you again. I will believe in you. I will believe in you. And I was really overwhelmed with that I'd made a priest cry. And then and I just vowed to be even more religious than I ever had been. Like, it was a huge, horrible thing. And then the priest left the church. And of course, in my egomania, it was like, because I told him there was no God. And then he started coming to our church just as a participant, as a congregant, with the housekeeper of the rectory, Barbara. And my mom would say, there's Father Wicks with Barbara. And then, of course, everyone thought, which was probably true, that he left the church to be with Barbara. the housekeeper, but in my mind it was like, no, it's because I told him that there was
I think you were right. No.
But I think I don't know why he was crying. I think he was having a lot of conflict.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, I think no doubt Barbara helped, but
yes.
I think that you were articulating the doubts that he felt.
Yeah, I think he might.
And he was driven to despair that somebody was actually articulating exactly what he thought. So I think you deserve the credit.
I don't know. I mean, like, I wonder what happened to him.
Well, maybe he joined the clergy project.
Yeah, he might have. Okay, that brings us to the clergy project. Explain what the clergy project is.
One of the things that the Richard Dawkins Foundation is doing and has done is to sponsor a website called the Clergy Project, where clergy people who have lost their faith, like Father, what was his name?
Well, it's so funny, because if it was in a screenplay, you would say, you can't have a name that on the nose, but his name was Father Weeks.
I was having dinner with the vicar in Oxford a few weeks ago, and he said that he had a priest friend who was called Father Christmas. True.
See?
True. Anyway,
see, if my people, name is Christmas, I would not become a priest.
Yeah. the clergy project would be absolutely tailor-made for Father, was it Leek? No, Weeks.
Weeks.
Father Weeks.
He's weak.
Yeah, he's weak. but actually, the members of the clergy project are not weak. They are in a terrible bind.
Yeah.
Because they have committed their lives to a profession in which they no longer believe. And it's not like a farmer giving up farming.
Right.
Or an engineer giving up engineering, because anybody can do that and that's fine. You change your mind, you get new interests, so you change. But if you're a clergy person and you lose your faith, you have to start living a lie, which is what many of them do, or you lose everything. You lose your friends, you lose your parents, you lose your children, you lose your wife, your husband, or that many of them are at risk of this. So in this website we set up, we made it very, very confidential. Many of them came in under pseudonyms, under assumed names. Their identity was very strictly protected. And they talked to each other on this website, crying on each other's shoulder, and in some cases, maybe literally crying, I don't know, and encouraging each other, comparing notes, and gradually working themselves up to coming out, which some of them have now done. There are now about 600 clergy people from many different denominations, Christians, Jews, and they're steadily, one by one, coming out and retraining. My original plan was not just to set up this website. If I'd raised a really lot of money, I would have had retraining scholarships so that they could retrain as carpenters or...
Like Jesus.
Thank you, you got
it. Okay, sorry, I always have to say that. Okay.
or as counselors, or as teachers, and I mean, some of them have done that. Some of them have come out and done that.
But it's even worse than you're saying, because when I did my show, Letting Go of God, I actually got a lot of emails from priests saying, "I don't believe, but what am I going to do?" And it's even worse because, you know, the priests, they don't even get Social Security. Like they opt out of that entire, you know, they have a special thing with the government where they are paid and there's no, like, so they can't leave. I remember one priest saying, you know, I'm 55 years old, like, what am I supposed to do now? I can't go.
I mean, I feel very sorry for them. I've got a friend who's much more hard-hearted and said, more fool you for going into it in the first place. But I actually do feel great, great, great sympathy. There's a book by Dan Dennett and Linda LaScola. Linda LaScola is a sociologist who did research on these clergy people, doing interview research. And she wrote a book jointly with Dan Dennett, the famous philosopher, about her findings and about what they conclude. Has my microphone gone off?
No.
Okay. About what they conclude about these clergy people. And we, the Richard Dawkins Foundation, is sponsoring a play that's based upon this book by Dennett and Lascola. I haven't seen the play. The play's not finished yet. It's being written, and there's been a read-through, which is apparently a great success.
Oh, good.
And it's going to be cut down for the actual stage version. So that's another of the enterprises that that we're engaged upon in the foundation.
Why don't you just tell a little bit more about what the foundation is?
Okay, I mean, there are those two things. Another one is sponsoring school productions of the play Inherit the Wind. There's a famous film of Inherit the Wind as well with Spencer Tracy and others. But it's a play, and we're sponsoring 90 schools to put on productions of this play. It's about the Scopes Monkey Trial, of which it's the 90th anniversary of the Scopes Monkey Trial, so that's why the 90 schools. And it's a wonderful play and very educational. It's fictional. It's firmly based upon the Scopes Monkey Trial, but with the characters' names changed. So that's another thing we're doing. Another thing we're doing is subtitling all our YouTube videos, of which there are a large number, in other languages, especially Arabic and Urdu and the languages where perhaps it's needed most. And finally, the most important thing we're doing is the Openly Secular campaign. You already know about that because you saw Julia's wonderful contribution to that. The Openly Secular campaign is an attempt to get people to come out and proclaim to the world that they are atheist or secular. And this is so important because in America, it's still an enormous numbers of people are in the closet with respect to this. It's rather like the gay movement was 20 years ago, when to be gay was something you had to keep quiet about. They were a bit of a pariah. Now that's all changed. The gay movement has been spectacularly successful in persuading people to treat gay people as the human beings that they are. So we're trying to do the same thing. And so we're trying to get not just celebrities like Julia and Bill Maher and Penn and Teller and people, we're also getting ordinary people to make short YouTube videos of themselves, YouTube selfies, where they say, I am a fireman, I'm a policeman, I'm a nurse, I'm a school teacher, I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, and I'm openly secular. And I'm obviously a nice person. You can see it looking in my face. I don't say that, but that's...
But so if you don't look like a nice person,
don't want that.
Okay.
No, we need nasty people as well. But can I encourage everybody to do that? And once a sufficient number of people do it, then it will reach a tipping point, and then the floodgates will open, as they did with gay people. And so that's, I suppose, is the main thing. That we're doing, the Openly Secular campaign. The Openly Secular campaign has its own website, which you can go and look at.
Now, I've just thought of this, but where do you come down on this spiritual thing? Because I feel like, we were talking about this for a second backstage, but in L.A., people would come up to me and say, oh, I'm an atheist, but what sign are you? And you've got to go to the psychic that I know. And so I realized that at least in Los Angeles and in the entertainment community, there were all these people who were not religious, but they were just as much filled with superstition and, you know, had... It was so crazy.
I'd almost rather they were Catholic than...
I know! I agree with that because I feel like, wait a minute, I guess I get worried about... Like, in some ways... Religion allows people to keep all of their crazy superstitions in one manageable place.
Yes, that's right. That's a very good way of putting it.
Because I feel like with people, if they don't have good critical thinking skills and don't understand the fundamentals of science, and not even deep science, just understanding that they don't have to have superstition, for example, or that psychics aren't real... they gravitate towards all, like, I think it's a natural part of our brain architecture to just gravitate in the absence of knowledge towards coming up with answers of why things exist, and most of those answers have are often most easily answered by superstitions and crap. And in LA, it's just rampant. And it made me so crazy. I felt the same. I'd rather be around a Catholic than a New Age person.
Well, let me tell you that my wife, Lala Ward, who was an actress, told me this story. She was in a film directed by the famous director Otto Preminger. And he was Austrian. And he was approached by a young starlet on this film, and she said, "Oh, gee, Mr. Preminger, what sign are you?" And he said, "I am a do not disturb sign." Yeah, I think it's very sad that people are. It suggests that if they become atheists, it's for the wrong reasons. It's for the it's for non-critical reasons. And I think it's very sad. We need to unite all our critical faculties. You talked about Catholics keeping all their beliefs in one place. We should focus our critical beam on everything, including religion, including homeopathy, including psychics and spiritualists and things. Not that I'm against the word spiritual if used carefully.
Okay, that's what I want to hear.
I dare say Carl Sagan would have called himself spiritual. But
he would have or not?
I don't know. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me in the same sense I would myself. I mean, you do get a feeling, a sort of tightening in the throat when you look up at the stars. You feel just moved in a poetic way, and there's absolutely no reason why we as scientists and atheists shouldn't be poetic. I hope we are. I mean, I think science is a wonderful vehicle for poetry. But it should never stray into superstition, supernaturalism.
Well, I used to really hold on to the word spiritual. Like, I would say, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. There was many years that I said that. And then a lot of people, because I was going to a lot of atheist conventions and secular things, and they were really challenging me on using that word, since it has, you know, religious roots. And then I was saying, but in the, you know, common parlance, people don't take it that way, and I think I can still use this word. But then I went to the other side, and now I avoid that word, because I try to just, I actually sat and came up with words, you know, like I actually made a list of words that I would try to go to instead of spiritual. Like, I would say that was a profound experience, or I felt great awe, or like I really tried to avoid it, because I think, even though I think it's fine that people use whatever words they want, I'm not in the word police or anything like that, but I feel like that's an interesting thing, because people like to say they're spiritual. I guess what they're saying is that they're open to the artistic, profound view of the world, and they like to use that word, but I actually am trying to not use that word.
I think you're right, because it's a word that's almost begging to be misunderstood.
Right.
There are people out there who are actually eager to misunderstand. I mean,
right.
We saw that eagerness in the case of, well, Einstein, for example. Einstein liked to use the word God, even, let alone spiritual. Of course, he didn't mean God. Einstein meant was that which we don't understand. So when Einstein wanted to say that what he really wanted to know was, is there only one way for a universe to be? Is there only one kind of universe? Did the universe have to be the way it is, or could there have been other universes? He said, what I really want to know is, did God have a choice in creating the universe? Well, that was his way of saying, is there more than one way for a universe to be? But needless to say, using the word God like that is just
Especially asking him to
be misunderstood.
Yes.
And so Einstein has been eagerly embraced by religious people who like to
claim. Oh, I know,
claim.
It makes me crazy. They go, even Einstein believed in God. It's
right.
He didn't!
No, he didn't.
Although, okay, but then on the other hand, I feel like God is such a useful metaphor. Like, I retain the right to use God as a metaphor. Because even in science, I know it's very useful to say, well, what does it want to do? Or this, you know, like looking at biology, like if you imagine a force or a design or why it's a certain way, like it's so easy to let that idea of God come in, and it can be really useful, but it's so misinterpreted. So I guess you just have to be careful.
Yes, what would be an example of that, though? I mean, apart from...
Well, you could say, like, the blood cells want oxygen. You know, like...
Oh, that's fine.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like, you're...
Yes.
Like, my husband's a scientist, and I often hear, Like, he ascribes motives to things that, of course, don't have motives, but it's just a useful way of talking.
Oh, yes, that's hardly got... I mean, I was once at a posh conference in Germany where I met the molecular biologist Jacques Monod, Nobel Prize winner, and he said, when I'm faced with a problem like this, I say to myself, what would I do if I was an electron?
Yes.
And physicists do it as well. You know the phenomenon of refraction, where a beam of light gets bent when it hits, when it comes out of air into glass.
Right.
Well, what the light beam is doing is minimizing the time it takes to get to the other end. Yes.
Interesting.
Well, the metaphor of the selfish gene is sometimes misunderstood as genes being conscious little devils. scientists, on the whole, don't misunderstand it. Philosophers sometimes do. I'm very sorry to say.
Now, Richard, tell me when you decided to spend so much... What was the reason that you really decided to turn your energies towards spreading the word of there is no God?
Well, I don't think there's much difference, really. I mean, I think it's all part of the scientific enterprise. I'm passionate about truth. And I suppose particularly as an evolutionary biologist, we... biologists are in a way in the frontline trench because we bear the brunt of religious hostility to science. Physicists do a bit with respect to the Big Bang, but biologists really, really do with respect to evolution. So I felt there was almost no choice but to fight against at least the religiously erroneous view of science, and I suppose I could have stopped there and not attacked those more sensible religious people who accept evolution and accept science, but somehow want to inject a sort of spiritual dimension into it. And that does strike me as dishonest as well, and so I go for that too. But I've never thought of it as a sudden discontinuity in my life changing from science to religion. I always regarded it as part of the same enterprise. And actually all my books take kind of sideswipes at religion, and then the God delusion does it in a more full frontal way.
But do you ever get tired of it? Like, do you ever want to retreat to a lab or...
Well, not really. I suppose it's true that I don't do lab coat research now, and occasionally I do miss it, but I wasn't all that good at it.
Really?
Well, I mean, I wasn't bad, but I sort of feel that I probably had more impact on the world by writing books, and if I'd devoted my life to doing research and publishing papers in journals, that would have been nice, but I don't regret doing what I have done.
It's like you discovered the memes and then you became a meme.
Yeah.
All right.
When we were in the Greek green room,
yes,
you told me a lovely story about nuns on the bus, which I hadn't heard before.
Oh. Well, I was just saying that I feel optimistic about the future, even though it seems like some religions, particularly Islam, is having a bigger resurgence of fundamentalism, and it seems like it might be going backward, you could say. Overall, I feel like they're humanity as a whole and the earth as a whole, things are getting better. And I really feel like this new pope is making things a lot better for Catholics. And I disagree with a lot of things that he says, and fundamentally I don't believe the same things he believes, but I really like what he's doing. So the example that I was giving, because my family's Catholic, so it's a lot of Catholic stuff, but there's these nuns that are real progressive, and they get out there and they, you know, strike, and they bring attention to income inequality. That's their main focus, is trying to help the poor and fight legislation that is making income inequality worse and things worse off for poor people. And they've made statements, and there's one sister that's sort of the head of it, but they've made statements like, you know, birth control is not, really shouldn't be the issue. That's not important. What's important is poor people and how everything's rigged against them, and that's their fight. And the last pope didn't like this group of women and had made a statement saying that they were not following the precepts of the Catholic Church. They should spend more of their time on sexuality and keeping, you know, like staying in the convent, basically. And then he appointed some archbishop in the U.S. to be in charge of them. And it was like, and my aunts, who are all very Catholic, but very progressive Catholics, were enraged by this. So then they were out protesting on behalf of the nuns on the bus. And then the new pope, as soon as he was in office, like a couple months later, he said, no, the nuns on the bus are doing the right thing. The nuns on the bus are saying they're fighting for the right causes. And then I went and saw the nun on the bus a couple weeks ago, the main nun, give a speech, and she was really great. And it really made me think, it made me just feel hopeful. Like, I feel like, even though I understand intellectually the argument that moderate Christians or moderate religious people in some ways are more heinous, you could say, than fundamentalists, because they're sort of partaking in the modern world, but then but they're still grabbing onto their religion, I feel like there's a progression. Like, I think it's better to have religions that accept maybe more progressive ideals or science, and I feel like this pope is doing that. I mean, not in every case, but in many cases, and I feel really hopeful about it. And I feel that just all the numbers that we're talking about, that we are hearing about here, like 25% or whatever of the U.S. saying that they're also nuns, not nuns on the bus. They're nun for religion. But I feel like that's very hopeful, too. I just feel very hopeful about the whole thing.
Yeah, let me inject a slight note of cynicism.
Oh, no!
Well, a few years ago in Oxford, I attended a lecture by a nun, and she was very progressive. She was pro-abortion, she was pro-contraception. She was against absolutely everything in the Catholic Church. And she got a rousing reception from the Oxford students. She was a great hero. And then she's saying all these wonderful liberal things. But why is she still a Catholic? And then I realized that this is her meal ticket. I mean, if she wasn't a nun, she would have been saying the same thing as everybody else in the room. It's because she was a nun that they thought it was remarkable.
I think that is a little cynical.
It is cynical. But I think there's a dilemma. Your point is a very good one, which is that you would like to see, in a way, the church subverted from within by liberal nuns and things. And you could argue the opposite way, which is, why don't they just walk? Why don't they just get out?
Well, because this brings up a bigger topic, Richard. Yeah. I don't know if you're ready to go there.
Okay.
But I feel like religion provides a lot more than dogma and stories. It provides community and ritual and history and music. And I mean, I've come to believe that the people who are Catholics that I know aren't in the Catholic Church because of a set of beliefs. They're in the Catholic Church because this is their culture. It's almost like being Irish or something. It's this part of their culture, and it gives their life meaning. And so I would say that nun finds her meaning in the Catholic Church, even though she disagrees with much of what the Catholic Church on the record believes in.
Yes. But they are swelling the statistics. They don't actually believe it, but they're recorded on censuses and polls and things as Catholic.
Right.
And so they swell the apparent numbers of people who are in the church, which the church then uses as ammunition. Say, look, we have so and so many million people in the world who are Catholic, and they then use it as propaganda in their mission to stop contraception in Africa, to stop condoms in Africa, and so on. So in a way, those people who are not really believers but allow themselves to be counted in the totals of Catholics are in a way betraying something, because they're being used as a head count. I suppose that's the kind of thing I'm thinking.
Well, I agree with you. But I would say that it's most transformation, I really think, is more likely to happen from within.
Yeah.
I really do.
Yes.
I actually encourage people who are in religions to stay in the religion, but say that you're atheist. Because, for example, I mean, not everyone, that's not for everyone, but
Well, what does it mean to stay in the religion then?
Well, like, okay. Okay, you know where I get it from? The Jews.
Yeah.
Because okay. I have so many friends who are Jewish, and they're atheists. They say they're atheists. They've always said they're atheists. Their family has always said they're atheists, but they still do Passover, and they still participate in the rituals. But they might go to synagogue on the high holidays or something, but they're atheists, and they're not afraid to say it. And I feel like, you know, you could say that's hypocritical, but you could also say sort of honoring a tradition that has kept the people alive and is part of their history. I feel like Catholicism is ripe for that, because I think within Catholicism there's just people saying, oh, I'm an atheist, but I'm, you know, culturally Catholic and I still participate.
Well, I say that. I mean, I say I'm an atheist, but culturally Anglican sometimes. And you know, I go to carol service and King's College, Cambridge, and things.
I think it's harder with more fundamentalist religions.
Yes, but I do worry about the betrayal aspect when you actually say you're... I mean, I don't say I'm Anglican. I say I'm culturally Anglican occasionally.
Right.
But I would never tick the Anglican box in a census form, which I'm guessing that some of the Jewish atheists you're talking about would actually tick Jewish.
Well, that one's complicated too, because it is an ethnicity also. But I just feel I've really changed my thinking over the last few years, and thinking more things should be happening from within than without. Because I think there's a certain type of personality that can leave the church, but I think that's not. There's more people who probably could be persuaded that the myths that their belief system is based on are myths, but will stay, than there is people who are willing to actually leave.
Yes.
And I think if you make it more okay for those people to say, oh yeah, that's just a myth, and just acknowledge that, I just think that change will happen better that way.
That's a debatable point. You could very well be right. I was talking one time to an ex-Muslim who clearly was an atheist, but went on saying she was a Muslim. So I said, well, why do you go on saying you're a Muslim? She didn't say, because I don't want to have my head cut off. She said, because I think I can do more good from within.
Yes.
It's exactly the point you're making. And I mean, it's definitely a very plausible point. I'm not sure how we decide which was the best way to go.
Well, I think it's in every way. I mean, that's how my personal view of the whole atheist movement has been. There's room for every kind of voice. Like,
yeah.
I feel like you are saying what you're saying. I don't agree with everything. Maybe not. I wouldn't be as strident or as negative about religion. But there's definitely
which,
a place
which of us
for that.
Sounds more strident?
And I think there's room for, like, Sam Harris to say what he's saying. Like, I think all these voices, there's room for all these voices. Like,
I agree.
There's like a big rainbow of people.
I agree.
And they're all their opinions.
Yeah. Yes. I was once asked by the Independent newspaper in London to contribute to a weekly column they had called Heroes and Villains. And you had to choose either a hero or a villain to write a short article about them. So I chose Pope John Paul II as hero. And obviously the joke is in the paradox. And I said I said that he's a hero because he is the best possible advertisement for this terrible institution of which he's the head. If people go on following him, this will hasten the destruction of the Catholic Church. Therefore, he's my hero. And would you believe it, some wretched sub-editor changed the headline from Richard Dawkins on his hero, Pope John Paul II. Richard Dawkins on the dubious heroism of Pope John Paul II. Totally killing the joke. And I'm doing a sort of one-man campaign against sub-editors of newspapers who write headlines which the author of the article never sees and has no idea about.
Oh, I know.
And I've simply lost count of the number of times when authors have waited with bated breath and seen their article and every word is correct, except the sodding headline, which,
right.
which completely ruins it. And
no.
It happens again and again and again.
I just had that happen to me. I mean, it's on a much smaller level, but I did an interview with Salon about my experiences at SNL and going to SNL 40, and it was like 99% positive. My feeling was so happy about it. I had such a good time, blah, blah, blah. And then She was asking me, and she was great, but she asked me something about, you know, I said something like, well, at some point it became more of a sort of old boy network with Adam Sandler and Rob Schneider. I said something, it wasn't, but, and then I said, even though I love those guys and they're really funny. And the headline was, Julia Sweeney finally spills the beans about the old boy network at SNL. Okay. And I was so angry about it. And, and actually the woman who wrote the article wrote to me and apologized for it.
Because it wasn't her fault.
Because it wasn't even her.
No, it wasn't her.
Yeah, it's just strange.
But I mean, I just remembered a similar story of mine. I wrote a book review of a book by a genuine hero, Peter Medawar, a brilliant Nobel Prize-winning scientist. And the book review was full of praise for the book, but it had one sentence which said, some people have described Peter Medawar as a loose cannon. And I absolutely repudiate this. He's not a loose cannon because, and I went on about why he wasn't. Came out, the headline was Shots from a Loose Cannon. So I stormed around to the office and spoke to the editor, who it turned out wasn't responsible. This was Redmond O'Hanlon. Have any of you read any of Redmond O'Hanlon's travel books? Do. I mean, they're so funny. he's an explorer who goes intrepidly to the most godforsaken, I almost said, places on Earth.
You use God as a metaphor.
Yeah, okay. And he... His house and his office are full of stuffed monkeys and cat's paws and various monuments to anthropology and anthropophagy and just wonderful curios. And so I bawled him out for about 10 minutes about this headline, Shots from a Loose Cannon. And he listened in complete silence. And then he left the room and he came back and handed me an object. It was a shotgun. Which completely disarmed me, as you could imagine.
I guess I wanted to ask you, I've thought of this. If you, like, I feel like religion can cause people to be better. Like, I feel like there are positive things to come from religion. They can make people more noble or more self-sacrificing and more giving. And do you think that it's worth it, in your mind, to have people be part of a religion if they're going to be better people, if the myths that religion is based on are being told that they're true? Like, does the fact that it's not true just negate any good thing that religion does, or for you, or what?
Well, let's try to analyze why it might make people better people. I can immediately think of two possible reasons that might be suggested. One is that they feel that they're being watched. So many of us will do good things if other people are watching us, because we like to be thought well of. But if nobody's watching us, then maybe we won't be so good. So one could make the case that people are good because they feel there's a kind of invisible spy camera in the sky looking at them. I suppose that's possible. That is possible. I don't think it's a very noble reason to be good. I think I would have more respect for somebody who's good because they really want to be good rather than because they want to impress either a person or a god. Mm-hmm. So although I concede that it might be possible that people are better because they're frightened of God,
but that's not the only reason.
No. I suggest that's one reason. Another reason might be suggested that they're good because they've read the Ten Commandments.
Well, that's a bad.
Which
thing.
Is a terrible reason.
So those are not good commandments.
If you've actually read the Ten Commandments, when they're hung up in the courthouse in Texas, whatever it is, I wonder whether the people who agitate for them have actually ever read the Ten Commandments. Or maybe they read the Sermon on the Mount, which is a lot better.
Right, that is.
That's genuinely good. You can find verses in Holy Scripture, in the Bible and the Quran, which admonish you to be good. You can find them if you look really hard, like the Sermon on the Mount. You'll find a hell of a lot more verses that are simply terrible in their moral persuasions. So you have to make a, you have to choose which verses to follow. And the criterion by which you choose, by definition, is non-scriptural. I mean, you're choosing among the verses which ones are good ones. And you're using a criterion of choice. You choose the Sermon on the Mount because by the standards of 21st century morality, it's very good. You don't choose almost anything in the book of Leviticus or Deuteronomy or Numbers or Exodus. Because by the standards of 21st century morality, they're terrible. But note the standards of 21st century morality. We have moved on dramatically. We are now much, much better people than we were a century ago, 2 centuries mm-hmm. ago, 3 centuries ago, beautifully documented by Steven Pinker in his book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, which I strongly recommend. We are getting far more humane, far more decent, far less cruel, and it's all for non-religious reasons. It's all something mysterious that goes on from century to century, even from decade to decade. And with hindsight, you can look back at your religious scriptures and find the verses which are in accord with 21st century morality and reject the verses that are not. But you're not using religious or scriptural criteria to make that discrimination. So I would reject both those two main reasons why religious people might be thought to be better. Maybe there are others.
My feeling is I started doing this thing about 5 years ago where I started going to different churches every Sunday. I was going to do this church project where I was going to go to, it was going to be a year of Sundays, and every Sunday I was going to go to a different church and write about it. And I kept notes on every church I went to, but I didn't write the book because I'm a terrible procrastinator. But anyway, but I continued doing the church project. And I still do it. I still go on Sunday, and I think it's fantastic. You can just walk into almost any church, and you can sit down. And my feeling after all of this is there isn't that much fire and brimstone amongst the churches I went to. It's really like, be a better person. We're all here. We're all vulnerable. We need each other. I mean, like, that's pretty much the sermon. It's like, it's not really that much about from the Bible. It's really, and I do feel inspired often by the sermons. Like, I feel like, this is a good thing, you know, people in the neighborhood are here, they're getting together, let's be better people, there's like a food drive, there's this in the basement.
Well, maybe we should all do that. I mean, maybe we don't need to be religious to do that. Maybe we should all get together.
Right. Well, I'm starting to feel that way. Because I feel like, I guess for me, my big epiphany is, I was religious, I liked being Catholic, it worked for me to a certain extent, I had what I thought was a religious experience even. And then I looked into it and found out that it was all based on, you know, terrible science and not true stories. And then that made me reject the whole thing. And now I'm in this new phase where I feel like, you know what? Like, when I told my mother that I wasn't going, you know, like I didn't believe anymore, and she sort of laughed at me and said, I said something like, I'm an atheist now, and she said something like, that doesn't mean you're going to stop going to church, does it? And I realize now that that actually wasn't a funny thing, because it is kind of true. I'm starting to think, from doing my church wanderings, that people don't even go to church based on what they believe.
They go
to church for all kinds of other reasons, and they're not bad reasons. They're reasons about getting together with the community. I mean, they can have bad, definitely, I agree with all the bad stuff, but there's also a lot of good stuff. And I, like when I first became an atheist and I went to all the atheist conventions, you know, I was in my strident phase. I was in my, oh, I can't believe how untrue this is, and how did people tell me things that were so obviously untrue and that they must have known were untrue. That, I was so outraged by that. But now I think, whether it's true or not, you know, it's like, it doesn't really, that's actually the least interesting thing about religion.
Oh, come on.
No, I really, I don't
okay, Julia,
think that.
Let me have another go at let me have another go at the thing about treachery. All these people you're talking about, they don't really believe, but they go to church. They are counted as members of this church or that church. Politicians in this country will look at statistics and they will say some very high percentage of the American population is Christian. Therefore, I've got to say whatever it is they say, God bless America, when at the end of
right.
every speech.
Yeah, no, I think that is bad.
And,
I agree, that's not
there
good.
There is a widespread belief that anybody who is not a believer cannot get elected to high office in the United
yeah.
States. And you're in effect agreeing with me that actually that's a myth, because the people who go to church are in many cases not actually believers. And you're saying, well, it doesn't matter if it's true. They go to church to have a good time and to have tea and biscuits.
Not to have a good time, but to have a...
Well, okay.
Saying a good time is not fair.
But the point is that they are perpetuating the myth that America is a religious country, and therefore politicians
yes,
have to... Yes,
I agree. There are some side things that happen from that are not good, and that is one of them. Being counted amongst the groups and having politicians cater to what they believe people want based on numbers is bad. But I also think things can be changed from within. I mean, there's many religions that are changed from within by the changing beliefs of the congregation. And so it works both ways, I think.
But when will it reach the point where a politician will no longer have to pretend to be religious? For the 535 members of US Congress, and a very substantial number of them have got to be lying when they say they're...
Oh, yeah.
They're religious. And I don't blame them for lying. They have to lie, or they won't get elected. I don't blame them for lying, but the reason they're lying is that they've been persuaded that the majority of the American population is religious. And people who follow your idea are helping to perpetuate that myth.
Yes, I agree. That's a bad thing. But I don't think it's so bad they shouldn't go.
Okay, but...
Because I think there's other good things that come from it.
Well, we could have a sort of... I mean, there is an atheist church in England where people go and they have a... If it's not a sermon, it's a kind
right.
of, I don't know, a lecture or poetry reading or musical encounter or something of that sort, which I'd be all in favor of. So
a
long
musical
as it,
encounter or so, something so
long,
of that sort.
So long as they don't, so long as they're not actually counted
right.
as religious, I would be all in favor of that. I think it would be great. I mean, I know you're kind of flirting with the Unitarian Church, and,
yes.
and that would be absolutely fine if it wasn't counted in statistics as a religion. Because what you're saying is that the Unitarian Church is doing all the right things, except they don't actually believe in God. But
well, that's part of the right thing they're doing.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Right. But it is true they get lumped in with religion. It is true.
Yes.
But I'm just saying there's a lot of different ways to change, and I think from within is one way.
Yes. Mm. Well, maybe we should throw this.
Yes, I think we need to ask for questions.
Ask for questions.
Can we have the house lights up so we can see?
We want to look at you.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Hello. I came here with the two fulcrums from which I was going to ask the question, and one was Rupert Sheldrake, and the other one was John Shelby Spong. But given the tenor of the discussion, I'm going to go with John Shelby Spong, because there was so much discussion about what might it take for existing religious expression to transform itself. And the reason why the focus is on John Shelby Spong is for whom I'm assuming you have some familiarity with his work. He's an Episcopal bishop who is essentially, he's written books.
Sorry,
like...
What was the name again?
John Shelby Spong.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, he's familiar with his work.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you're then aware that he is an atheist in that he does not accept the theism upon which most religious practice is based. He also refers to religion as a cultural experience, which is
yes.
very along the lines that you mentioned. So the question really becomes, is that an exemplar? Is that a path through which we can retain the value that arises out of that cultural expression that we've called religion, and like a chrysalis, remove that sort of theism that is really a distortion of that of what we understand to be God.
I think this is a fascinating question, and it really raises exactly the issue that we've been talking about. And I may have sounded more strident than I meant to, because I think that Bishop John Shelby Spong is obviously an extremely good man. I've met him. I've had dinner with him. And he's an extremely nice man. How you can say I don't think he actually says he's an atheist, but he probably is.
He says atheist. That's great.
I really don't get how you can go on being a bishop. Julia would say that's great because you're subverting it from within, and that I think.
I know.
There's a similar man in Scotland, Bishop Richard Holloway, who ended up, I think, head of the Church of Scotland or something like that. And he, too, is pretty much an atheist. He called himself a recovering Christian. and I've had, I think, three, hardly call them debates, similar encounters with Bishop Holloway on the stage in Edinburgh. And he's another extremely good man, a delightful man. And it's really not clear what he's doing, but it looks as though there's at least a strand of opinion that Julia represents, which is that you can do a lot of good by subverting the church from within. And maybe we need both ways of doing it.
I've really come to that. I feel like what you're doing is great. I think that what they're doing is great. I think it's all part of this whole shift of humanity. I do. And I think, even that clergy project, I feel like those priests who just say, I'm an atheist, but here I am, I'm also your priest. I don't know, I think that'd be great.
Up there,
maybe? Oh, someone up there.
Up way up here in the heavens.
Yes.
Two quick, 1 point, one question. First, the point is, well, you talked about the use of the term spirituality as being leading to misinterpretation. As a qualifier, I have to say, I'm not an atheist, I'm an agnostic. It's between me and whatever I think. I don't care what you think. But spirituality doesn't bother me, but when you mention that right after that, that you can use the term, what does this gene want to do in the terms of Darwinism? I think that leads to way more, it opens up way more misconceptions and misuse than the term spirituality. A gene doesn't want to do anything. It does what it does because it doesn't have a choice.
Yes, it is very important to understand that the gene doesn't actually want anything.
It bothers me a lot when people I talk to say, well, why did this do that? Why did it do it? There is no why. It did it because... Yeah. Why do we breathe oxygen? Because that's what we have.
It's very important to get the point that it is only a metaphorical way of doing it. It is a way of getting the right answer. And the alternative might be that instead of saying, why does the gene do what... The gene does what it wants to do in order to get propagated. If you're studying lions or studying elephants or studying jellyfish or something... The alternative might be to say, what's the lion trying to do? What biologists have done for a long time.
Yes, and what you just said, why does the gene, what
if
does
you,
the gene want?
If you
want,
say, what does the,
what does the gene
lion...
want to do? The gene doesn't want to do anything. It does
I,
what it
I get
does.
Your point.
Yes, okay.
Okay.
Okay, but then the other one, and I'm not sure if this
Let me just answer that, please.
Okay.
For many years... people would have said the equivalent, which would be, what is the lion trying to do? And that's much more tempting, because the lion is an obvious agent. It's got a brain, it's got limbs, it's got muscles, it's got nerves, and it really is obviously trying to do something. But if you actually work out, in Darwinian terms, what the lion is trying to do, it's doing something very complicated. It's not trying to survive, or only trying to survive as a means to the end, of passing on its genes, not even just to reproduce. That includes helping the genes of other relatives other than offspring, nephews and nieces, brothers and sisters. So you get the right answer if you switch the focus of your attention to the gene and say, what is the gene trying to do? You've obviously got to accept the point you're making, which is that the gene isn't literally trying to do anything. How could it? It's only DNA. The temptation with the lion is much greater because the lion has a brain. The lion really is trying to catch an antelope. But to do your Darwinism, if you do your metaphorical teleology and say, what is the gene trying to do? You get exactly the right answer because you take in all the nephews and nieces, the grandchildren. Whereas if you try to say, what's the lion trying to do? The answer is the lion is trying to maximize a very complicated mathematical function which amounts to trying to preserve its genes. And so teleology at the gene level works absolutely fine, just so long as you can get over the hurdle of realizing that, of course, it's not really trying to do anything, but it's as if it was trying to do something. Then you get the right answer. The mathematics becomes much more simple.
Oh, this is why I love Richard Dawkins. That answer! God, I love that! That was so eloquent and great.
Who's got the mic?
We're not in control.
Whoever's got the mic, speak.
We're moving toward the back there.
Okay.
I didn't think the mic people were going to come in this area at all. Hi, Richard. Part of what you guys were talking about at the end there, you were saying how people who continue to go to church but might not believe everything are giving people the impression that America is a religious society. Part of my question to you is, well, to who? And if, because it seems to be, you cited politicians as one example, which was leading to how a politician can't come out and say, I don't believe in God. Part of this feels to me like when somebody like myself comes out as gay to family and friends, and then I run into all these people that are closeted, and I say, you're doing a disservice to the rest of us openly gay people by not coming out. It feels like there's a very similar parallel to that with what you're saying. Can you comment on that at all and elaborate? I guess part of me really wants to hear you talk something about how there could be some good that comes out of religion too, because some people might just be emulating Jesus in their own mind. They might be saying, well, Jesus loved everybody and, you know, gave to the poor and whatnot like that. So that could be some good that comes out of religion as well. But I kind of hear a very staunch opposition to that and talking about the motives of, actually they're just afraid. So they're doing good doesn't really matter. Does the motive really count in that case?
I only heard part of that.
Well, I only heard part of it, and it was to you, not me. But yet, I'm going to say something. That's a good point. Like, if people are staying
in the
closet...
Well, can you say what the point was?
Well, I mean, the beginning of what he was saying was that some people were gay, and they came out, and that had a big, profound effect on the people that knew them. And then there were other people that were in the closet, and they... And the person who was out was saying, well, you're doing a disservice by being in the closet to people like me. Like, the more people who come out of the closet, the more acceptable it will be. So that's sort of a parallel. Yeah. I was thinking to staying in a religion and not and secretly not believing, but being part of this religion. It's not helpful for the truth to come out about how things are, is what I think.
Okay, yeah.
Which I agree, but I don't think that you should pretend to believe. I think you should just say you don't believe, but you're still part of the church. That's my personal
okay.
feeling.
I mean, perhaps I should add that one of the things that happened in the gay coming out was that people would out other people.
Right.
And I think that's a quite a wicked thing to do, actually. And we're the openly secular campaign is most emphatically not in the business of outing people. We're in the business of trying to consciousness raise
right.
and encourage people to come out of their own accord, recognizing that in many cases it can be extremely difficult because of the pushback that you get, worse than pushback, that you get from family and communities and things.
Yeah.
Hi, Richard. It's my turn. Right here.
Where are you? Oh,
I'm in the front. Very short and to the point. What are your thoughts of the rise of Scientology in America?
Is it rising? After that documentary, is it rising? I thought it was going away. Like, actually, I thought they only had 50,000 members now, actual members.
I'm curious where they get their money from. I mean, they seem to be...
Well, because they extorted money from people for so long, they've built it up. Like, Hollywood is completely overrun. The real estate.
Yes.
Anyway, don't get me started on the Scientologists.
Yes. what's bizarre about it is that it's even more recent than Mormonism. And so you can see the whole development of the whole thing. It was started by... I've forgotten his name.
L. Ron Hubbard. And it's twice as crazy.
Crazy. But the thing about L. Ron Hubbard was that he honestly said, "This is how I'm going to make my fortune by starting a fake religion," and people still fell for it. It's just money for old rope. I mean, Joseph Smith did it in the 19th century, and he was a known fake, a known charlatan,
right.
And he invented it all. And yet, there are thousands of Mormons today who just seem incapable of seeing through this obvious mountebank with golden tablets, which he translated not even into 19th century English, but into 16th century English. And what's that about? I mean, it's just got fake written all over it. And it's just that those two churches, Scientology and Mormonism, are recent, and so it's kind of more obvious that they're fake.
But doesn't it seem like what Scientology shows me is that people are just going to believe in shit no matter what? Like even if you succeed and everyone leaves, it's almost like I get scared that it's better to keep the big traditional religions that have all different aspects to them, the more liberal parts, the more conservative parts, than it is to just unleash millions of people out of their religion so that they can join even crazier groups of people.
I agree. Yeah. Yes.
I don't know.
Sam Harris and Christopher Hitchens, both great writers and speakers on the importance of getting rid of religion. Could you tell us one thing that you think each man does really well and one thing that you think each man could have or could still improve upon?
Christopher Hitchens and Sam Harris, one thing they do well, one thing they could improve upon. Well, Christopher Hitchens can't really improve upon anything.
I think Christopher Hitchens... got it wrong over the Iraq War.
My God!
I think he's also wrong on abortion. He was.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So I never argued with him about either of those things. A good rule in life was never argue with Christopher Hitchens. I think. I mean, his reasons for supporting the Iraq War were extremely passionate. He'd been to Iraq. He'd seen what an utter monster Saddam Hussein was. But I wonder whether even he, if he saw the aftermath now, where almost certainly we could say that ISIS is a consequence of the American invasion of Iraq.
I did argue with him about Iraq.
Did you?
Yes. I mean,
I'm sure he was very gentlemanly about it.
No, I was so angry at him about that. But anyway, I did love him, but that was wrong. He was wrong. He's wrong.
Sam Harris, many people criticize him for his spiritualism, his almost Buddhism. I think it has to be said, he's not a religious Buddhist. I mean, he believes in meditation. And has practiced meditation for much of his life. He's an expert meditator. And I think he thinks of it as a sort of physiological technique, which is immensely valuable, and Buddhists have had many centuries in which to perfect it. But I don't think he can be blamed for actually being religious. He's not. He's one of the most clear-thinking...
where he's wrong? Even though I do love him,
yeah.
And we are friends, but his views on gun control are crazy.
Oh, yeah, yes.
I mean, he's really...
Yes.
Anyway.
Yeah.
But I love him. I do love him.
Thank you so much for all that you do. Excuse me, I'm really terrified right now. So I'm a high school biology teacher. I teach 10th grade biology.
Yay, biology!
And my students and I just finished an exploration of human evolution in my classroom, and I had a student ask me a phenomenal question that—
Can you talk a bit slower?
Oh, I'm sorry.
And louder!
My students and I just finished an exploration of human evolution in my classroom, and my student asked a really great question that I've struggled with because I am, I'm not openly secular, because as a teacher I have to maintain a fine balance of, you know, how do I work in a relatively religiously conservative community and maintain a good relationship with my students and keep them open-minded in the classroom. But the question was, my student asked, my faith says one thing, but science says another. What do you say?
My what says one thing?
My faith says one thing and science says another.
Wait, my what says one thing?
Faith.
My faith.
Sorry, yeah.
I thought it was my feet. It was like...
Yep, nope, their feet aren't saying anything.
The problem is the loudspeakers are facing out into the auditorium, so we're not hearing it properly up here.
So my faith says one thing and my mind says another.
You're a teacher, and did you say that you have problems with teaching science because people say to you, my faith says one thing, my science says
I would
another?
Like to know, how do you think I should respond to a question like that when I don't feel comfortable admitting that I am openly secular in a religious environment? And how do
is
I keep students
school?
Be open-minded, but explorational at the same time, if that
so
makes
how,
sense?
So how should you respond to what one of your pupils?
Yes.
Is that the question?
One of my students. Sorry, maybe this is...
Yes. Well... Your faith is rubbish.
But I recognize that,
That might not be very helpful. I recognize that. I'll leave it to Julia to
give
the...
Now I would be softer. I would say some people might say your faith is rubbish. Not me. Just people I've heard. I would say... I think your faith is your culture, and you want to give honor to your culture like everyone does, because humans need other humans and communities. And when you say faith, I think, well, I guess then you're telling them what you think. But anyway, I would try to say something that doesn't dismiss faith as a bad thing, but redefines faith as being a participant in a community you love. See? Switcheroo. And that's important, but also understanding the facts of science is really, really important, because that's going to make you a smart, skeptical, good... You're going to know how to get through life with all of your great critical thinking skills, and part of that is understanding biology, and that part of that is seeing the world in a biological way. Something, I would do something like that.
Yeah, I think that's good too. I mean, I think that... I mean, another thing you might say is, okay, your faith, where does it come from? If you'd been born in Afghanistan, would your faith be the same if you'd been born in Bombay?
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a really good one.
Do you have any real reason to believe the faith that your parents and grandparents happen to have brought you up in, as opposed to the faith that you would have been brought up in?
Although, like my mom would say, well, God has provided a lot of different religions for everyone to be part of based on where they grew up. Like, I mean, you know, like, there's ways to think of it and still believe and just say everyone has their own expression, you know, but ours is Catholic and theirs is Hindu and theirs is this and it's all good.
Well, I would hope the child would see through that.
Hi. I'm going to university for zoology, so this is for Richard Dawkins. I was wondering, do you remember the time you fell in love with biology or zoology? And if you do, could you express that to us? Because I'd love to know about it. Like, do you remember the moment, or do you remember why you decided to study it?
To study zoology?
Yeah, when, oh, okay. When you really knew.
I don't have a very good story about that. I'm sorry to say that I was never a dedicated bird watcher or flower collector or insect hunter. I'm not a naturalist.
That's a good title for a book.
Yeah. the naturist naturalist. I drifted into it, really, because my father really was a naturalist. And so I kind of followed in his footsteps without really knowing why I did. And that's not a very good reason to do anything. But that meant that when I got to Oxford, I read zoology at Oxford. And then my interest really did take off. So I was rather a late developer in that respect. And the interest that took off was more of a philosophical interest. It was the power of biology to answer the big questions of existence. Why are we here? What's it all about? What's the purpose of life? These are questions which traditionally religions have tackled and failed at. And I recognized that biology was the field which could answer many of those questions. Not all of them. Physics can answer the others. And so about in my second year at Oxford, I became deeply enthusiastic about biology and read a lot of books. But it was always the philosophical angle. And only lately have I started to become more of a naturalist. I'm still no good at identifying birds, but I'm happy for hours with a pair of binoculars looking for them.
Hello. So 39 years ago, in your wonderful book and my all-time favorite book, The Selfish Gene, you coined the term meme. And now that term has memed into something completely different, used on Facebook and the internet daily for, you know, craziness that's nothing to do with your original definition of it. What is your thoughts on how the term meme has memed?
A meme is just the cultural equivalent of a gene, insofar as there is a cultural equivalent. I wanted to demonstrate that at the end of The Selfish Gene, which was all about genes, that Darwinism can in principle work with anything that is self-replicating in the universe. And in principle, it could be quite a lot of different things, and may be a lot of different things on other planets. But I thought it would be helpful to look on this planet and see whether there was another possible self-replicating unit which could potentially serve as a unit of Darwinian selection. The meme, the unit of cultural inheritance, anything that spreads like an epidemic through society, like a tune, a clothes fashion, a craze that spreads through a school, a toy that all the children want to have. Any of those things are potentially a meme if they're copied with high fidelity from brain to brain, and therefore are possibly subject to a natural selection of a sort. The tunes that get whistled around the streets are good tunes, not bad tunes, etc. Now, the internet was unforeseen, certainly unforeseen by me at the time when I wrote The Selfish Gene. And it has, of course, proved to be an amazing ecology for memes. When I wrote about The Selfish Gene, I was thinking of people whistling tunes to other people. I wasn't thinking of memes spreading at the speed of light, practically, through the internet. And so the internet has provided a superb ecosystem of memes, and that's wonderful. And there's even been rather interesting research using the internet. There's one very nice example, which was a few summers ago, there were riots in London. I can't remember what the original cause was, but people were rioting and smashing shop windows, and there was chaos in the streets, and the police were having difficulty keeping control. And during these riots, there was a rumor that somebody had released a tiger from the London Zoo, which was rampaging through the streets of London, terrorizing the city. This wasn't true, but it provoked a rash, an epidemic of tweets on Twitter about this tiger. And somebody had the bright idea of representing this graphically on a map where you had circles whose either area or diameter, I forget which, was proportional to the number of retweets of the tiger rumor. So you had green circles geographically representing retweets of the tiger rumor in London. And then there were red circles representing tweets and retweets of a counter, not rumor, quite a, I mean, the anti-rumor, which saying, no, there's no tiger, it's all lies, it's all. And gradually the green circles were replaced by the red circles. And so you could actually see the natural selection of the truth in this case, which was that there was no tiger, taking over from the wild rumor that began, which was the... So that was a beautiful example of natural selection of memes, in this case, of retweets. What you're talking about, the so-called internet meme, is a very particular subset, which is a silly picture with a caption. To the extent that those things spread, they are memes. But what would be very wrong would be to think that that's what a meme means. It's just a tiny, tiny subset of what a meme is.
When one's a Christian, they're taught that they're the center of the universe, the purpose for creation. And when one abandons Christianity or many of the other Abrahamic religions, you're thrust into this position of having to understand these moral questions of our place as humans amongst the rest of these creatures that seem to have a purchase on life as well. Daniel Dennett, whom you mentioned, has answered this question himself, but I want to know from you, Professor Dawkins, as a biologist and atheist, how you've wrestled with the morality of how we as humans relate to animals, questions like eating meat or keeping them captive in zoos.
The biology of morality, or the evolution of morality, is that the question?
How do you feel about how our relationship is with animals? Understanding that we're another animal, like the fact that we're eating animals trapping animals or caging animals.
Right. I think that evolution does have moral implications in this respect. Our morality, pretty universally, is speciesist. This word coined by Richard Ryder and popularized by Peter Singer. By analogy with racist. So it's taken as pretty axiomatic in our morality and our political system even that the human species is unique and has an absolute wall around it, and all other species, we've got to treat them kindly, but they're not human. I mean, they're somehow other. So there's humans versus the rest. And so when you get something like the abortion debate, all the argument is, when does human life begin? Does it begin at conception? Does it begin after the last possible opportunity for these embryo to split into two and make identical twins? Because that would raise the embarrassing question of which twin gets the soul. Think about it. Or does human life begin at this trimester or that trimester. Note that all the emphasis is on human. If you could just point out quite simply that the human embryo is quite obviously far less capable of feeling pain or fear than an adult cow or pig. Yet because a cow and a pig is not human, that's somehow ruled out. It doesn't matter. They're not human. The human embryo is human and therefore is sacred. Well, this is deeply unevolutionary, obviously. Another way to express that would be to say, imagine as a thought experiment, and nothing wrong with thought experiments, that the intermediates that link us to, say, chimpanzees had happened not to go extinct. We are linked by our ancestors going back to whatever it is 8 million years ago to the common ancestor with chimpanzees, and then there's another set of links from the common ancestor to modern chimpanzees. That means that if only they hadn't gone extinct, we would be joined to modern chimpanzees by an unbroken chain of intermediates, all of which would have been classified in the same species as each other. There would have been no sudden cutoff point, all of which could have mated with, in a fertile way, their immediate neighbors in the chain. So if you imagine the chain ranged out across, as I've done, across Africa, with humans at one end and chimpanzees at the other, holding hands. And each one in the chain would be the same species as the next one in the chain and capable of interbreeding with the next one in the chain. And yet at one end we have humans, the other end we have chimpanzees. And you could do the same thing for any other animal you like. You could do it for kangaroos, humans and kangaroos. There is always going to be a chain of intermediates linking us to every other species, a chain of intermediates, every one of whom would have been regarded as the same species as its neighbor. It's paradoxical, but you can see immediately that it follows from the evolutionary worldview. It's a matter of sheer accident that the intermediates between us and chimpanzees are all extinct. That's the only thing that enables us to be speciesist and to lock chimpanzees away in cages in zoos or do experiments on them, which we would not do. We wouldn't do to a human embryo. And do we really want to base our morality on the merest accident that the intermediates just happen to be extinct? It's a very convenient thing that they're extinct because it really does mean that we can draw a line around the human species because there aren't any intermediates. And it's very unlikely that any intermediates will be discovered. And one can make the thought experiment that somebody might find intermediates in some African forest. That would throw us into a moral pandemonium because you'd then have to have, in order to maintain our speciesist morality, you would then have to have courts of law like they had in apartheid South Africa to decide whether somebody passes for white. You'd have to have courts of law to decide whether some intermediate passes for human. Fortunately, we don't have to do that. But that's just two indications of where the evolutionary worldview potentially could drive a coach and horses through our present moral system with respect to other animals.
Okay, this is the last question.
Yes, before I ask my question, I want to thank you very much for spending some time with us. Richard, I believe that most of our experience would say that the first time we heard the word truth, definitely an absolute truth, but even the word truth, was during catechism or religious classes, not during science classes. And that science is more about the method, the hypothesis testing, not about the truth. I feel that you have a different interpretation about that. Could you please explain?
Well, this is an orthodoxy in philosophy of science, that there's no truth. All we can do is to fail to falsify our approximations to the truth. And certainly the history of science can be interpreted in this way, that hypotheses get set up and then they can be rejected or they can fail to be rejected. And if they fail to be rejected, then they go forward and they regard it as an approximation to the truth. But we don't actually use the word truth because it's always open to the possibility of their being falsified one day. This is a respectable strand of philosophy of science. I think it can be exaggerated. I think that there are plenty of things that we now know absolutely are true. We know that the planets of the solar system orbit the sun. That's not a hypothesis waiting to be disproved. It's just plain true. And we have under our belt now quite a large number of things that we know are true. There are other things that we don't yet know are true. There are other things which can still be regarded as hypotheses that have so far failed to be falsified. If you want to reconcile these two points of view, you could say something like this. The hypothesis has not yet been falsified, despite numerous strenuous attempts to falsify this hypothesis, and therefore it would be perverse to withhold the accolade of truth from this hypothesis, and that would apply to the hypothesis that the planets orbit the sun. In my view, very strong view, it would apply to evolution. Evolution is just plain true. The evidence is so strong that to withhold it would be perverse to say anything else. The hypothesis that natural selection is the main driving force of evolution, that is a hypothesis which is open to doubt, is open to criticism, is open to test, and so I would not say that that's definitely true at this stage. But I think that particular kind of philosophy can be exaggerated. Before we finish, I just wanted to say, in the book signing, I'm always delighted to sign books. It's a great pleasure. But we do have a big crowd tonight, and I hope we'll have a very big book signing queue. And out of consideration for those who find themselves at the end of the book signing queue, I'm going to ask, as your indulgence, that you don't ask me to personalize my signature. I don't know whether Julia agrees with that, but
I disagree. No.
Okay. It seems to me to be unfair on the people at the end of the line if I spend a lot of time trying to work out how to spell a particular name, and with love to Uncle Charlie and things like that. I think we both agree about selfies as well, that they also take an enormous amount of time.
Yes.
And we absolutely hate them.
Yes. Selfies and youth seats. Also, the book that's for sale, that's my book, isn't my most recent book. That God Said Ha is about me having cancer and my brother having cancer that I wrote 20 years ago, before I lost my faith even. So I would encourage you, if you were looking for a book of mine, if you've already bought it, it's a good read. I'm glad you bought it. But if you were looking for something of mine, I wrote a memoir a couple of years ago called If It's Not One Thing, It's Your Mother. And then also, Letting Go of God, you can get from Amazon. It's on DVD. And
strongly recommended.
That's the best way to have my thing.
Yeah.
But I'm happy to sign your books. And that's it. We have to get up very early in the morning, too.
All right.
Thank you very much.
This has been really great. Thank you.
This was really fun.